Hello and welcome to another episode of the PropSwap podcast. We are your hosts, Ian Epstein.
And Luke Pergande.
And we are also the founders of PropSwap, the first marketplace to buy and sell sports bets. Thank you so much for joining us this week. We've got another great episode for you. It is going to be all Super Bowl props, predictions, storylines. It will be a jam-packed episode talking about the big game coming up on Sunday, 49ers Chiefs. The consensus line right now is 49ers are a 2-point favorite, 2.5 at some books, and about a minus 130 favorite versus Chiefs plus 110 underdog. And the total has been sitting consistent at 47.5. Luke, we will be there for a couple of days in Vegas. Those are both of our old stomping grounds. I'm excited to see kind of what Vegas is like for Super Bowl. I mean, Vegas is a scene when the Super Bowl is in a different city. So I'm super curious to see what it's going to be like. I have a feeling this is going to be like what people thought F1 was going to be in terms of the crowds and how packed things are going to be. And F1 was kind of a letdown, but I feel like this is going to be something that Vegas is made for. But before we get to Vegas, you'll be in Phoenix for the Waste Management Open. I went there years ago in college, haven't been back since, but I know it's something that I think almost every guy would want to go to. What are your thoughts and feelings on the Phoenix Open?
Here's the hot take for you. I might be more excited for the Phoenix Open than I am the Super Bowl. It is the best. I think it's the best sporting event I've ever been to. I was fortunate to go to the Los Angeles Super Bowl, and as I echo most people that say this, it's so corporate inside the stadium. It's like no fans. It's all, you know, MGM people or Gatorade people or friends of a player whose team didn't even make it. Like, it's just so sterile inside of the Super Bowl. Obviously, we're not going to the game. We'll just be there for the festivities. But yeah, there's just not a lot of passion inside the Super Bowl, and rightfully so. It's $9,000, you know, a ticket. So it's extremely expensive to get in there. So Phoenix Open will be great. Always is the most attended golf tournament in the world. Weather in both cities, though, I definitely think is stifling my excitement. I mean, 55 and rainy at the Phoenix Open Wednesday, Thursday, and Vegas. I mean, we're talking 40s this weekend. So not a great forecast for either event.
Yeah. You know, people ask me if I'm going to the Super Bowl. Obviously, you know, say no, you know, I got to work it. Plus, yeah, the expense of it. But like, you know, going to a football game, like if you really want to watch the football game, being in the stadium is like not the most fun, because like, you know, being in a game, it's about like talking to people around you, and you know, you're getting up for drinks or bathrooms or, you know, whatever. And you know, it's you know, you go to a game, you want to be about the experience and not so much like watching a play by play. But I feel like that's probably why the Phoenix Open is so great, because like, you know, there's a golf tournament going on, but like you're just there kind of mingling, and from what I can tell, like the no, you know, you don't have to be hush hush, you know, everywhere the entire time. Obviously, the 16th hole, you definitely don't have to be hush hush. So I think that's probably why, like, it's just a great, yeah, it's like, it's a big giant bar with a golf tournament happening, you know, happening to be going on in the background. But I'm sure we'll have some stories from both cities on next week's pod.
I just wanted to add in, I said this on the pod after the Los Angeles Super Bowl. I remember when sitting there, Odell Beckham was on pace to win MVP. He was having a killer first quarter. I think it was like mid second quarter. He went down, and I was checking Twitter. That's how I found out about it. But anyone in the stadium was blind to the fact that Odell was out for the game. No PA announcement, no sign flashed on the digital board. And that's just, you know, a critical situation that you were unaware about when you're sitting in the stands. But obviously, if you're sitting on the couch, I don't know if it was Romo and Nance back then, but we just were totally unaware that he got hurt. So just one example of something where you go to the game, you're totally blind to a critical play.
Yeah. I was at the game Broncos-Jets a couple years ago when Breece Hall had like a season-ending ACL injury, and it was on a touchdown run. So I'm like, oh man, like this guy, he's about to have a great game. And all of a sudden I'm like, wait, I haven't seen him on the field again. And it's like, oh yeah, he's ACL tear. He's done for the season. Totally. But talking about Super Bowl action so far, you know, only a week of action so far, and this upcoming week is when the real action comes. But just some kind of tidbits: 85% of the money line bets are on Kansas City. But the first $1 million bet was reported by Caesars, and it was on the 49ers. A nice little tidbit from our friend Ben Fox. He quoted a Vegas odds maker as saying that, quote, "With the game in Vegas, I anticipate double or triple the number of seven-figure wagers as usual." So my immediate assumption is just that, like, high rollers are gonna assume that, like, maybe if the bet a large amount, then that could lead to free tickets, versus if the game was in Dallas, let's say. It's like, you know, what is flying into Vegas to bet seven figures, you know, really going to get you? Like, you know, a couple drink tickets. And so I don't know, maybe just, because tickets are so limited and these casinos probably have a bunch, you know, maybe that's part of the reason why Vegas is going to see more seven figure. Now, that's not to say these guys wouldn't have made seven figure bets in other states. I'm guessing that the Vegas sports books, you know, will get more seven figure bets than usual. But my question to you is, you know, assuming that that's true, that there will be more seven figure bets to come this week, do you see that moving the spread or money line considerably? I mean, we've been seeing kind of bouncing around from 1.5 to 2 to 2.5. It's been all under a field goal. Do you see an influx of money coming in on either team?
Yeah, I mean, I disagree with that quote. I don't think it's going to be triple the amount of $1 million bets, but just because it's in Las Vegas, there's many, many places you can get down these days. I would say I think this spread should be 3.5, -3.5 Kansas City. So I think this will move towards Kansas City by game time. Put that quote aside from the odds maker. I do think this spread will move by Sunday afternoon.
Yeah, I mean, look, if they're used to getting 5 7-figure bets, then, you know, maybe they get 10. So, you know,
that's fair.
I'm not really sure how many they get in previous years. But, you know, obviously a ton of storylines that everyone else is hitting, you know, Brock Purdy, Travis Kelce, Taylor Swift stuff. But here are some storylines that I feel like not enough people are talking about. And so, Luke, you tell me. Big deal, little deal, or no deal at all. The first storyline, and this came out Monday afternoon, is about the 49ers practice field. So the Chiefs are practicing at the Raiders facility, which utilizes the same type of grass as the stadium, but the 49ers are practicing at the UNLV facility. Now, while UNLV does play at Allegiant Stadium, they do not play on the real grass like the Raiders do. They play on a field turf. So the NFL put in a sod field over the UNLV practice field turf, but they only started laying it down like a week ago. The NFL hardness score, that's Adam Schefter's words, not mine. The NFL hardness score for fields averages 78, with no field being less than 70. The 49ers practice field is considered in the 50s right now. And if you recall, there was playing surface issues in last year's Super Bowl, like in the actual game, at where the Cardinals play, which led to players slipping all over the place. So 49ers getting shafted on the practice field, big deal, little deal, or no deal at all?
I think it's a little deal. Certainly you brought up the field during the Super Bowl, which is different than this situation. This is just the practice facility, but little deal. I mean, 7 days of slipping around, and maybe there's an injury that occurs over the next 7 days. Of course, I hope not. But it's relevant for sure. I mean, I don't know why the Chiefs got the Raiders facility on a coin flip or how they decided that. But yeah, it's relevant.
Yeah, clearly it wasn't based on regular season record. But I knew that. I mean, maybe it's an AFC thing versus, you know, AFC, because it's an AFC host. Maybe that's why. But yeah, I mean, look, I don't think the 49ers are going to be doing any sort of like real practicing and drills. I think it's a lot of just like kind of walkthroughs, and it's not like they're going to be like, you know, installing a ton of new plays. So, but I would agree. I think it's a little deal. I mean, it's, I don't know how a $15 billion corporation can't can't get the field straight, you know, these fields straight for their biggest game of the year.
Last year's game was brutal.
It was terrible. I mean, it's like, yeah, the fact that like we're talking about, you know, players slipping on, you know, the second story that I feel like not enough people are just talking about is just the fact that the Chiefs play in this stadium every year. The Chiefs are 4-0 at Allegiant Stadium. Mahomes at Allegiant averages 313 yards a game with a 10-1 touchdown to interception ratio. And then just generally speaking, Mahomes indoors, 13-1 record, 306 yards a game with a 34-3 touchdown to interception ratio. So the fact that the Chiefs play in the same division as the Raiders and they are 4-0 in that building, big deal, little deal, no deal at all.
I think it's a big deal. Yeah, I think comfortability, play, you know, ins and outs of the stadium, crowd noise, locker room, setup, just no wrinkles to iron out for Kansas City. I think it's relevant. I think it's a big deal.
Yeah. You know, we'll save my pick, but I think it's a big deal, but I'm hoping it's not a big deal if you know where I'm going with this. But you know, you can't discount the fact that like those stats are against the Raiders, defense and not the 49ers defense. But yeah, I think there's something to be said about, but that being said, the 49ers also played, in that building last year, as well and had a good game, but obviously that was only one game versus, four games for the Chiefs. The last storyline, and I feel like no one really talks about this until like the game is going on or the game is over and you hope that it doesn't become a storyline, but the referee, or I should say the referees, the head referee is a guy named Bill Vinovich. I hate this guy. I can't really like explain it. And like, I used to be way more locked in on these refs than I am these days, but like, I can't tell you like, just anecdotally speaking, if I bet a game and then he comes on the TV, I'm like crap. I'm like, I'm a gonna lose this bet, or like there's just gonna be some weird stuff. So I just do not like this guy. You know, he was the referee for the Saints Rams NFC Championship game, which of course was the no call on the pass interference that led to the Rams beating the Saints. Of course, we had that gigantic sale with Cousin Sal and Clay Travis. They bought a Saints ticket, so there's one example of just a weird, wonky game that he calls. He was also the referee for the 2019-2020 Super Bowl when these two teams played. So he's the first referee ever to referee a rematch of the Super Bowl. Chiefs won that game, so take that for what that's worth. But I'll stop there. I mean, big deal, little deal, no deal at all about this guy.
Rams Saints game, that non call at the end of the game on the Rams defensive back was one of the worst non calls in professional sports history in a relevant game. So I mean that in itself is embarrassing. Relevant also that he ref the prior game. So that's also kind of weird that he would get to do that again. So yeah, I think that's a big deal. There's a difference between throwing the game and being incompetent. Like, I don't think he's throwing the game, but meaning like giving calls to one side so he wins his bet or someone else wins a bet. But I do think there's something to be said about incompetence. And then it's like, okay, who gets the raw end of the shaft there and gets an incompetent call missed or called on? So that's just annoying for all gamblers that are trying to, you know, Roger Goodell had a press conference and he's so bad at press conferences. He never answers any questions. He was asked about what's your process for solving the referee's inaccuracy this year. He's like, well, we're incorporating technology. It's like, are you? Cause we haven't seen that in the field basically at all. So yeah, it's a big deal. It's relevant and annoying for gamblers.
Yeah, and look, there's a ton of judgment calls that technology is never gonna solve. But and the other thing too, and this has been talked about, you know, for years, is just the fact that when it comes to the playoffs and including the Super Bowl, the create these crews that did not work together during the regular season. It's like an all-star crew for each position, and it's something else that I don't understand is that, you know, these referees are teams themselves, and in the most important games, you are cobbling together guys who have never worked together. And that also makes no sense to me. And that leads me to the next referee thing, is that the umpire is a guy named Terry Killens. Now, the umpire's main job, he kind of stands near where the linebackers are, and his main job is to assess line penalties, offensive and defensive line penalties. Killens used to play in the NFL, including a full season plus some playoff games for the 49ers. And Killen's crew, which he was a part of a different crew than Vinovich's crew, ranked sixth out of all crews in offensive holding calls. And the Chiefs ranked second in the league in offensive holding penalties, including one of their players like set a record for like the most number of penalties called on him. So is that going to be a deal, you think, that you got the umpire sitting back there and maybe, you know, play for the 49ers and he likes to throw flags on the line and the Chiefs, even Nick Bosa said it the other day. He was like, yeah, I was watching film and yeah, the Chiefs hold a lot.
I mean, that specific part of this topic of the Chiefs holding a lot, them being ranked second offensive holding, that's relevant for sure. I don't think this guy's going to throw the game sixth in offensive holding. You know, it's not super of an outlier, you know, if it was one or two, okay, more of an outlier, but yeah, I don't, no deal. I'll go with this one.
Okay. I wouldn't be, I mean, I was trying to find an over under on penalties, which I could not find. If maybe they'll come up later, but I wouldn't mind, you know, depending on the number, placing an over bet on the number of penalties. Sure. So yeah, we'll get into our picks later, but you know, I hope, let's just say this. I hope the you know, the get the Chiefs if there are some blade and holds, and you know, don't let them play, you know, because the 49ers do have a fantastic defensive line, and you know, I could see them trying to do everything they can to hold them back. But let's move on to just kind of the game overall. Momentum. How important you think is that coming into this game?
It's a real thing. It's definitely a real thing. Anyone that says it's not is not watching enough sports. So I looked up teams that have had to play in the wild card round versus not. Right. So San Francisco was out of bye in the first week. They did not have to play in the wild card round. Kansas City was did participate in the wild card round. They beat that was the Bills game.
Dolphins
game. So teams that had to play in the wild card round versus teams that didn't have to. So basically Kansas City versus San Francisco in this example. The wild card round team. The wild card round team is 10-5 straight up. And 12-2 against the spread. So basically saying that teams that haven't sat out a game versus only playing against a team that did sit out a game are massively favored. 10-5 straight up or 12-2 against the spread. So it's relevant.
Yeah. And look, I mean, we saw that with both the 49ers and the Ravens in the first half of their divisional games where it looked like they both came out flat in the first half there. So, sure. And this is another example where they're coming off a bye week for the 49ers. You've got a good stat here: spread versus money line. In 31 Super Bowls of a 6-point spread or smaller, the straight up winner has covered 29 of 30 times. So, is that basically saying, you know, if you like the 49ers just to lay the points? Yep. versus the -130 money line.
Totally. Yeah. And yeah, same thing with Kansas City. Like don't get +2, just take a money line. It's better payout.
Yeah. I totally agree with that. You know, I think the same thing applies in the regular season as well, where, you know, if don't bet a team, you know, if it's a short spread, you might as well bet them money line, or, you know, don't bet a team plus the points if you don't think they can win the game outright. Because yeah, the instances where a team wins but doesn't cover is very far and few between, and it's got to be a spread like 7.5, like we saw in the 49ers Lions game. A spread of less than 3 is rare for that to happen.
Yeah.
But all right. So before we get into kind of our favorite prop bets that we like, just wanted to promote, give a shout out. We are running our biggest contest ever. We are giving away $1,000 in bonus cash. It is a prop contest. Answer 10 questions. If you get all 10 correct, you will have a chance to win $1,000 in PropSwap bonus cash. If no one gets all 10 correct, then we'll still be giving out $250 in bonus cash. And it's fun questions like, you know, over under Usher songs during halftime, over under how many minutes of the game clock until Taylor Swift is shown. But also we've got, you know, game props like who will have more first downs, who will have more passing yards. So definitely give that an enter. Doesn't cost anything to enter. Just got to have a PropSwap account. Go to propswap.com/contest. That is propswap.com/contest to enter and have your chance to win $1,000 in bonus cash.
It's like well done by that Jim Nance or Ian Epstein on that on that ad read.
I've watched so much football recently that your boy is the king of I can do some promo reads right now. All right, it is that time. Let's get into our favorite prop bets for Super Bowl 58. Actually, before we get in, I'd be curious what from an overall perspective, how do you see the game playing out? Because I think this will probably influence some of the picks that we're going to say. So just generally speaking, how do you see this game playing out?
Yeah, it's funny. Super Bowl weekend is always a great weekend for networking. And the second one I ever went to was in Miami, and it was this game. It was the rematch of these two teams. So San Francisco and Kansas City. And I walked into the Wheels Up party, and Scott Van Pelt was in there standing at the bar by himself. He's 6'7", bald, can't miss the guy. And we ended up talking for 30 minutes. And I remember walking away after we talked for 30 minutes. And I was like, so how do you think the game goes? And he just motions. He's like, low. I think it's going low, meaning, you know, take the unders on a lot of different stuff. And indeed it did. I believe the under did hit in that game. There was a lot of low points scored. So in terms of props, I think that's going to happen again. San Francisco's offense scares the crap out of me recently. I'm not ready to go this extreme, but it feels like Philadelphia was just like a wagon for most of the season. Then just like the wheels fell off. So that scares me. And I think the Kansas City defense is great. So I realize they lost their defensive end. He had 7 sacks. We'll talk about that more in a minute. But yeah, low is my, as Scott Van Pelt would say, low.
Yeah, I would agree. You know, I think back to the Patriots-Rams Super Bowl where, you know, it was the high-flying Rams, Sean McVay, Jared Goff offense versus Tom Brady. And it was one of the most boring games I can remember, let alone Super Bowls, 13-3. The most exciting thing about that game was that we had a like no touchdown to be scored prop listed for sale for a little bit at 500-1. Obviously a touchdown did end up getting scoring, but like that was like the most exciting thing about this game.
3-0 at the half. Brutal.
Yeah. I think about one of my most successful Super Bowls, short of me losing way too much money on the no safety, was Seahawks Broncos, and I was just going around in downtown Vegas book to book, finding huge discrepancies on like Demaryius Thomas receiving yards and just different Broncos players, you know, totals and betting unders on all of those. So you know, especially as we get closer to the game time, the public is going to want to bet yeses and overs, and so, you know, maybe you want to wait, but I also I'm looking at some of these unders on stuff. So let's get into it. The first one that I like, And this can really go either way, depending on who you like to win the game, is the halftime full-time prop, where basically it's saying, you know, who will be winning or will it be tied at halftime, and then who will win the game. In San Francisco's 14 wins, they were up at halftime in 11 of them, tied in one, down in two. Those two coming in these previous two playoff games. The two first times they were down at halftime this season and then won the game. In Kansas City's 14 wins, they were up at halftime in 10 of them, tied in two, down in two. So my point here is just like, you know, I think a lot of people want to predict like, oh, KC up at half, 49ers come back to win because that's what they've seen recently. But generally speaking, the team that's up at halftime is going to, you know, goes on to win the game. And obviously, you know, you're trying to dodge a tie game at halftime, but 49ers to lead at halftime and win the game, currently plus 160 at MGM. Obviously that's compared to a minus 130 for them just to win the game. You can also just do the same thing for KC leading at halftime and to win the game at like plus 190, plus 195. So I would be looking at that as a way to get better odds on the winner of the game and just, you know, hope that they're up at halftime. And then obviously, if that team you bet is up at halftime, there's obviously also an opportunity there to sell the ticket during the second half as well.
I like it. Good find. I agree. I think if I could get plus money, obviously you're getting plus money on the favorite on a team to be up at halftime and win the game. I like that.
All right. What's your favorite prop?
So this is like the Super Bowl version of the Nerfy, as people like to call them. No run, first inning, just quick wins that a bet would get decided in the first 20 minutes of game time. The Chiefs have scored on their opening drive in 8 straight playoff games. Now, granted, that could be a field goal or a touchdown, but they've scored 8 straight playoff games. You can get first drive Chiefs rushing touchdown at 7-1 at DraftKings. Most other books are around like you can get like 2-1 on just an offensive touchdown, but the way this team likes to run the ball in the red zone, likes to run the ball at the goal line, I like 7-1 on the Chiefs' first drive to end in a rushing touchdown.
All right, so low scoring game, but the go down and score.
I thought about that. Drive. So what the Chiefs love to do with a lead is run clock. So obviously this is a bet that they're going to go up early, just like they did exact same game script as Baltimore. Go up early and then just run the clock for the rest of the game and keep the ball out of Purdy and Shanahan's hands, respectively.
Yep. No, that's exactly. We talked about that. That's exactly what they did against the Ravens. All right. My next prop is any player to score 2+ touchdowns. Yes is minus 185. So obviously you're laying a little bit of juice here, but, you know, between McCaffrey, Pacheco, Kelsey, you know, maybe, you know, Mahomes doesn't really get many rushing touchdowns, but, you know, it's just any player, to get 2+ touchdowns. You get the feeling that one guy is going to be playing well and they're just going to keep feeding him the ball. Mm-hmm. You know, and this one kind of stands out to me because it's like, you know, the fact that the yes is juiced to minus 185, it just kind of makes me think that, like, there's a reason why it's so highly juiced. Like, it happens way more often than you would think. And it's kind of like, trying to think of an example, but like, you know, whoever scores the first touchdown, you're like, cool. Like, that's my guy now for the rest of the game. Right. Or, whoever, basically at halftime, if there's a couple different guys with touchdowns, like, now those are your guys all second half. And so, it'll give you a lot of options, throughout the game. And again, something else you can probably sell on PropSwap. So I realize minus 185, a little juice there, but I think it happens way more than you would think. And you're not trying to guess, will it be McCaffrey or Pacheco or Kelsey? You know, you just get any player to score two+ touchdowns.
Yeah, you talked about this on the last podcast. Money's money. If you're going to take the Niners at minus 130 to win the game on the money line, like, an extra few bucks of juice, just take this. And I agree, this is more fun to root for as well.
Yeah. And, my first pick was kind of predicting the winner. But as we kind of go on here, I think it'll be fun to, I think people would be wise to be looking at props that are not dependent on who wins the game. And, you know, if you just say, hey, I think it's going to be low scoring. I'm not sure if it's going to be Chiefs or 49ers. Could be a close game, but low scoring, like, or high scoring, regardless, like, you can have fun by just betting some of these things that are not dependent on, you know, who wins the game. And so you're not like sweating bullets, you know, in the fourth quarter and Phil Vinovich is on the microphone and you're cussing him out. All right. What's your next prop?
So this is from the most professional sports bettor that we know in terms of finding props over these next 2 weeks. That's his, like, it's literally his Super Bowl. That's all he does from the championship weekend until now. So he found this: Purdy's first rush to be greater than 3.5 yards over is +105. So over 3.5 yards, Purdy's first rush would pay you plus money. If you strip out the kneel downs, his yards per carry is 3.7, and that's his overall yards per carry. And then if you look at the last two games, this guy's ran wild. Now, it seems like it kind of takes him some time. Mahomes likes to do it from the jump. It seems like Purdy kind of gets comfortable and then does broken plays. But, I mean, he ran wild the last two games, said Purdy. So, first rush over 3.5 yards, I think, is intriguing.
Now, does that include sacks or no?
I think it does.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. I believe it does. I think a sack, I'm 90% confident a sack would go against your carries.
Yeah. But yeah, generally speaking, I like it because he's not really a designed runner, so it's more of a scramble. You know, he's probably smart enough to, you know, not scramble out of the pocket unless he sees some daylight. So I like it.
Lastly, yeah. On this prop, so this is where I want to talk about the Charles Omenihu guy, the Chiefs D end who is out. He had 7 sacks, relevant, not earth shattering, but he's out. So I do think Purdy will continue his ability to scramble.
I like it. Speaking of rushing and scrambling, shortest touchdown scored under 1.5 yards, -150 at FanDuel. So look, I think if you've watched enough football, you've seen enough pass interferences called in the end zone. There's a PI in the end zone, ball gets placed at the 1. Obviously, you got to punch it in at that point, but you know, you get the ball spotted at the 1-yard line, whether it's PI or just through the natural game flow. Then punch it in, boom, there you go. Now, granted, neither of these coaches are Dan Campbell, where he'll be for sure going for it on a 4th down. These guys are a little more conservative, so you know, obviously you run the risk there where if they don't get it on the first 3 downs, these guys are more likely to kick a field goal than a coach like Dan Campbell. But you know, it's one of those things where you're actually gonna be rooting for pass interference calls in the end zone, get the ball spot the 1. So yeah, shortest touchdown scored under 1.5 yards, currently -150 at FanDuel.
Yeah, and these teams love to run the ball. I could totally see whether it's a flag or a Pacheco or CMC goes down, and they just want to punch it in from that 1-yard line. So, yeah, I think this is probably my least favorite of the ones we've talked about, just because, like, that's, you know, I trust both of their offenses enough to not get down at the 1, but yeah, I still like it at -150. There's value there.
You know, and the Chiefs do not run the tush push or any sort of QB sneak because no. Mahomes got hurt on that one time and like they basically stopped doing that. So, you know, you're not getting that boost. But yeah, they both have goal line backs that they trust, McCaffrey, Pacheco, and they have no problem, you know, feeding them and not doing dumb, you know, fades into the corner of the end zone.
Those kill me.
Yeah. All right. What's your next prop?
So this also came from the professional prop bettor. Any player to have combined rushing and receiving 150 yards, no, So basically under, all players will have under 150 yards, is only minus 115. And his quote is, any single player not named Christian McCaffrey would have to have a career day to achieve that. And then even with CMC, his yardage total is 130. So you're getting 20 extra yards on this prop, basically gambling that, you know, 99% of the time, no other player is going to come close to that. So you're basically getting a CMC under at a good price.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I like that. I mean, Debo would also be in that conversation. But yeah, no, totally.
Still,
I mean,
career year for 150.
Yeah. Career game.
Career,
yeah.
Day, career day.
Yeah. So yeah, basically, yeah, no player to combine for 150 rushing or receiving.
They also have like stopped running the ball with him this year with Debo. Obviously you got CMC on the roster, so things change, but yeah, he doesn't really run the ball anymore.
Yeah, that's true. And look, cause he would get hurt doing that. And so, yeah. When he got hurt in the Packers game, I think Shanahan was quoted kind of after the game as basically being like, you know, it's one thing to go into a game knowing, you know, you won't have a guy, but when a guy gets hurt during the game, I mean, it completely just, you know, it just tosses out a huge chunk of your playbook. And so, again, part of the reason why he struggled so much against the Packers was him going down in the first half. All right, my last one, longer odds here, after giving out some minus money stuff. I found this on Superbook's website. They're available in Nevada, Arizona, Colorado, a couple other states, but this was like a kind of a pre-made same game parlay, but you can make this parlay on any other book. But again, back to low scoring game and not having to pick the winner, but game total under 40.5, Travis Kelce under 70.5 receiving yards, Mahomes under 262.5 passing yards, Purdy under 245.5 passing yards, and you can get odds of plus 750 on that. And so, the game's, let's say, 21-17, then, you're looking good there. Again, I like Mahomes under receiving yards. I like Mahomes under passing yards and Kelce under receiving yards. I think both of those numbers are going to get inflated. Like you said, they're going to want to run the ball, maybe control the clock. And so again, this is not indicative of the Chiefs' chances of winning, but I think the Kelce props are going to get so inflated on the yardage. Cause he had a great game against the Ravens, but like overall this season, it was a down season for him. And I think people are going to be looking at the last game and not really the season as a whole. And so, under on the game total 40.5, Kelce, Mahomes, Purdy under plus 750 odds. So a little bit of a long shot there, but you don't need to pick the winner there.
Yeah. Yeah. What do you do with the Travis Kelce situation? Obviously they showed a bunch of graphics during the AFC championship. He is now, I believe, the leading receiver in the history of the NFL for the playoffs. Like he has the most receptions.
Above Jerry Rice,
It's like, are we going to get Travis Kelce from last week, or are we going to get the only, it's silly, but like the only thing I can think of is just having a bad season because he's focused on other things like traveling the world with the number one pop star. Like, but that's the only solution I have to why he's been underperforming, but it seems like he's figured it out. So I'd just be concerned about that Travis Kelce number, the 70.5, but I'm with you on the other three. I definitely think the game's going to go under. I think Mahomes will be in like the low 200s. And then, yeah, I don't think Purdy throws for 250.
Yeah. And look, I mean, that game total 40.5 is obviously lower than the normal total. And so you can play around with that. You know, if you want a number higher than 40.5 and just stick with the regular total 47.5, obviously you won't get plus 750, but you'll still get good plus money on that. But, you can definitely combine a bunch of these unders together, to get some longer odds. So, all right. Before we finish up, let's move on to Super Bowl MVP. We kind of talked about this a couple weeks ago. I was talking about CMC at 6-1, and how you'd be able to flip that for more than just the 49ers, money line. Obviously it wasn't pretty, but the the 49ers got there against the Lions, and you can indeed flip that 6-1 CMC MVP ticket for more than the -300 money line was going to pay on that game. Look, this is a quarterback award predominantly. It's hard to believe that the Chiefs would win and Mahomes would not win the MVP. It's a little easier to see the 49ers winning and Purdy not winning the MVP. But I think we both wanted to just kind of look down the sheet and find some longer odds. Again, these are things that can easily be flipped on PropSwap during the game. As you know, sportsbooks keep these odds up. The value meter and suggested price on PropSwap will be refreshing as the game goes along. And so kind of along the lines of it being a low scoring game, defensive battle. When you look at the past non-QB winners in more defensive games, like there is precedent of a defensive player winning the game. Von Miller won it when he wreaked havoc against Cam Newton. There was a Seahawks linebacker that won MVP. Smith. Yeah. So my long shot MVP pick is going to be Nick Bosa, currently 100-1 at FanDuel and MGM. He's up there at the top of the league in terms of number of sacks. You know, he doesn't get as many tackles as Fred Warner, but in terms of, again, this is a voter award, right? So you got to think about, you know, who's going to pop on the TV and make the plays at the critical times. And so in a world where the 49ers defense stifles Mahomes and they are just, you know, in his grill all game, it's going to be a guy like Nick Bosa who's getting the pressures, getting the tackles for losses, getting the sacks, and just, you know, maybe a forced fumble here or there. And so when I look at defensive players and you know, he's the one that kind of stands out as the superstar potential that can shine this game. So Nick Bosa 100-1 to win MVP.
Yeah, I do agree with you. Of the defensive players, that's probably my favorite to, you know, playing along that game script. How does San Francisco win? You shut down Mahomes. Who's going to shut down Mahomes? Bosa is the most likely candidate, so I get that. So I was just going to throw out another defensive player like we discussed last week. 20% of the time, two of the last 10 Super Bowl MVPs have been defensive players. So one a little bit longer odds, almost, you know, 40% more on your money. Chris Jones at 140-1 to win MVP. That's at FanDuel. He's basically 100-1 everywhere else. So check out, if you make sure you're price shopping for all this stuff. And then I also like Pacheco. He's 35-1 at FanDuel and MGM and only 28-1 at DraftKings. So some value there regardless of what happens. But to your point, these are prop swap specials. This is like Chris Jones has a sack or the San Francisco's hasn't even scored in the first half. Like flip that thing on PropSwap for 3 to 4 times that you paid. Same thing with Pacheco. Pacheco has a long run, maybe for a touchdown. Flip it on PropSwap.
Yeah. Look, I'm not gonna tell anyone not to make that bet, but I just can't imagine the Chiefs winning and Mahomes not getting it. Again, even if he only has like one passing touchdown, it's just like he's gonna make the critical plays at the critical times and everyone's just gonna be, you know,
yeah,
and throwing their love for Mahomes. So but look, if I like Pacheco more than Kelsey, right? Because it's like someone's gotta be throwing the ball to Kelsey. If I had to pick an offensive player on the Chiefs, not named Mahomes, it would be Pacheco.
Yeah.
There you have it. All right. But before we go, just quickly, I think the listeners can probably tell by this point who we're going with each, but who's your pick for the game?
Kansas City.
I flip flop back and forth. I started out by going 49ers, and then I thought to myself, there's no way, you know, it's the storyline, you know, Chiefs, Kelsey, Swift, like, and now I'm back on 49ers. I'm going to trust my gut. It's been my pick all season long. I would hate myself if I flip my pick and then the 49ers won the game. So I'm going with my gut. It's been my pick all season long. San Francisco 49ers win the Super Bowl, getting revenge from 4 years ago. So that will do it. You know, it was a long one, so thank you to all who stayed along. Price shop, go for two. Be active on PropSwap this weekend and during the game. Like I said last week, the conference championship was our best conference championship ever in terms of number of tickets sold. I would assume the Super Bowl will be no different. So be checking PropSwap, be price shopping, going for two, enjoy the game, have fun. Make sure to subscribe to this podcast, leave us a rating, and we will talk to you next week.